I think we can start. Can you hear me?
Yeah, so should we start?
Yeah, we'll start.
Okay. So good evening, one and all. And I welcome on behalf of V Brown Medical India Limited, all the participants and our eminent faculties in today's digital dialogue on principles of fluid therapy and fluids in critically ill COVID-19 patients by Dr. Sanish as well as Dr. Anup Kumar. So moving on. We'll quickly share the objectives of today's webinar. You will all agree that a fluid therapy is one of the most basic yet important part of clinical treatment. And with the variety of fluids available, the complexity of choosing the right fluid is always challenging at times. And over the period of time, fluid therapy has also evolved with newer concepts, and balanced fluid therapy is one concept which is rapidly changing the way fluid therapy is practiced over a long period of time. So today we have our eminent faculties, Dr. Anup Kumar as well as Dr. Sanish, who have extensive clinical experience in managing critically ill as well as intraoperative patients respectively. And we can gain a lot of insight from their rich knowledge and clinical experience in this conclave of fluid management. So quickly running through the agenda. So we will have welcome introduction of the speakers and the background of the speakers, which we will try to finish within 5 minutes. Then next 1 hour or 50 minutes, we will have the keynote addressed by Dr. Sanish as well as Dr. Anup Kumar. On the principles of fluid therapy as well as fluids in critically ill COVID-19 patients, whether to use balanced or unbalanced, and followed by a 15-minute question answer session post two lectures. So the overall duration of this conclave will be 1 hour 15 minutes in total. Let's come to a brief introduction of our faculties today. Who come with the wealth of experience, clinical experience with us. Dr. Sanish PJ, who is having over 17 years of clinical experience and who has authored 2 textbooks in anesthesiology, a lot of publications in various index journals in anesthesiology. He has also been a speaker and faculty in academic programs, CME's workshops, both for anesthesiology and critical care. And is very active also in teaching via his YouTube channel as well as the website. His special interests include academics, clinical research, and difficult airway management, neuroanesthesia, and neurocritical care. I welcome Dr. Sanish in this webinar. Our second eminent personality today and faculty today is Dr. Anup Kumar, who's from Baby Memorial Hospital, and he's head and chief of critical care department. With a wealth of 20 years plus clinical experience, he has set up the first closed multidisciplinary ICU in Baby Memorial Hospital, and which is the first such unit in Kerala state. He has also diagnosed and reported Nipah outbreak on 18th May 2019 within the first 36 hours of patient admission, which helped in early containment of such deadly disease outbreak. So quickest diagnosis was later appreciated also by WHO, CDC, as well as UNO. So Dr. Anup also has helped improving ICU facilities in many hospitals as a consultant, active in online teaching again with a YouTube channel and website. His special interests are infectious disease, neurocritical care, as well as clinical nutrition. So welcome Dr. Anup in this webinar. There are few quick rules or digital meeting guidelines. All the cameras of participants will be switched off, also muted microphones. You can send your questions via the chat. Chat box is there in the app. And we will try to answer all your questions within the time frame. The training presentation is recorded. All the presentation as well as the audio is going to be recorded, and that can be shared with the participants for further review. A quick disclaimer: the views and opinions expressed in this following presentation are those of the individual presenter and should not be attributed to B. Brown, its employee directors, or any other organization with which the presenter is employed or affiliated. These PowerPoint slides are intellectual property of the individual presenter used by their own consent. So with this, I hand over the platform to Dr. Sanish, who will talk on the principles of fluid therapy. Over to you, Dr. Sanish.
Okay, thank you very much. Very good evening to one and all. I can see many familiar names in the attendees panel. A very warm welcome to this webinar. Today we are concentrating on IV fluid principles and its implication in the critically ill patients with COVID. Okay, thanking Esculap Academy once again, let me start my talk. We'll be discussing on the principles of fluid therapy. I think there is a live poll appearing on your screen, so you can attempt so that we'll come to know how you perceive about this particular topic. Okay, I bring warm greetings from our academic initiative webinar campus, mainly aiming at training in acute care medicine, including anesthesiology and critical care. Also, I am bringing greetings from my institution, Ananthapuri Hospitals and Research Institute, Thiruvananthapuram, Kerala. Okay, the agenda for the first half of this lecture would be simple. I have kept it very simple. We'll discuss basic concepts, how the ideas on Starling's law got evolved into or after incorporating the present glycocalyx model. We'll have an overview of the IV fluids options available and how we move towards the idea of balanced solutions. And then I'll introduce you to the great fluid debate, because this, as it was mentioned in the introduction itself, is a very basic topic, but it's very controversial thing, because not many principles are rightly set with the strong evidence base. I'll remind all my friends who had seen the lecture by Dr. Anup Kumar on the IV fluids overview, what you need to know. The video is still available in our YouTube channel. Okay, first, let's do a timeout. Think about your weight. The question is, what is the percentage of body water? If you are interested, you can put the answers in the chat box, but I'll proceed. So it's, for an adult, it's roughly around 60% of the body weight. When it comes to both extremes of age, it varies. Newborn, it comes up to 75%. And seniors, elderly age group, geriatric age group, it comes to as low as 50%. And what does body water do for you? It's there with almost every cell, every part of your tissue. It's basically flooded with water, even our bone tissue. So there are enough literature supporting the predominant role that water holds in our making up of the human system. And now we'll look into how the fluids are distributed in the body. So I have drawn some cells here. So whatever is the water, the space inside the cell, we can designate as intracellular space. What is outside, we can broadly put it as extracellular space. Again, we'll zoom into the extracellular space. You can find the interstitial space, the space between the cells, and our intravascular space. This has been our conventional idea. Okay. And what is their sticks? Intracellular space takes almost 55% of the fluid content. Extracellular space, the remaining 45%. And there were investigations into how this extracellular space water or fluid is distributed. This is the consensus. You can find the brown or reddish intravascular space, which contributes to 15%. The interstitial space in orange color contributes to 45%. And then what about this 40%, which is a significant proportion? That is the contribution by transcellular and other spaces. So this is the new perspective with which we are going to look into fluid therapy. Okay, so long pending questions like volume expanding efficacy of different fluid resuscitation strategies could not be explained with the conventional theories. The observed flux of fluid across the endothelial barrier was a perplexing question, and it led to the revision of the classic Starling principle. So Starling principle was with the idea that whatever fluid exudes out from the arterial end of the capillary comes back at the venous end, which is actually not true, because a good significant proportion comes back to the circulation through a different channel, which is called as the lymphatic system. And that is generally neglected for simplicity's sake in the initial fluid exchange or translocation theories. So that brought us to the new endothelial glycocalyx concept. Now I want you to concentrate here. Here I have drawn endothelial cells with their basement membrane, and in the intraluminal surface, you can find glycosaminoglycans spread in the intraluminal surface of the endothelial layer. And it forms a glycocalyx layer, and that imbibes or consists of a good amount of fluids. Okay, so now we have two different kinds of fluids, circulating plasma volume and non-circulating glycocalyx fluid volume. And now this is not a permanent fixture, because as the physiology changes to pathology conditions or stress conditions, things do change. That is making the things complicated for us. Here you can see during sepsis or any additional stress, the glycocalyx layer gets compressed because of the shedding or flaking of glycosaminoglycans into the plasma. Just to bring our memory back to the what is the physiological one, or healthy glycocalyx layer, which contains glycosaminoglycans, you can appreciate the difference. This actually influences the permeability of the vascular system. This is the enlarged picture of the glycocalyx membrane, the intraluminal surface. You can see this broad picture, endothelial layer and the glycocalyx layer. And inside the lumen, you can find the red blood cells and other cells getting translocated through the blood vessel or vascular space. The enlarged view, you can find the healthy glycocalyx, which is actually holding some plasma proteins and fluid in equilibrium. And during sepsis or any stress, it changes the structure. The glycocalyx gets damaged and the membrane becomes more leaky, and even the bigger molecules escape across the membrane. So this is the key determinant in the membrane permeability in various vascular organ systems. What are the implications? Previously, we were taught that 500 ml of colloid is equivalent to 1,500 ml of crystalloids. That means a ratio of around 1:3 or 1:5, which was not true, which was not found in clinical settings. It was around 1.3 to 1.4 ratio. That is because the change in leakiness with different pathological aspects. This new theory also explains why the infusion of iso-oncotic colloid fluid will not reverse the existing interstitial edema, because in such conditions, the membrane permeability is in a new different role, a new different setting. The effectiveness of fluid resuscitation is said to be context sensitive. As the condition evolves, the membranous leakiness changes, the flakiness of the glycocalyx changes with the stress or sepsis, and it varies depending on the changes. It is likely, but not yet proven, that protecting and restoring endothelial glycocalyx in these conditions will improve outcome, which actually interests in our discussion for the day, because there are a good number of literature supporting that the balanced salt solutions will preserve the glycocalyx better than the unbalanced or previous conventional intravenous fluids. So how do you describe IV fluids? If I ask you, when do you actually prescribe intravenous fluid, which actually should be considered just like any other drug, you cannot simply say you start an IV fluid. We have to mention what preparation, what dose, how long to give, and what route to give. So in a nutshell, for IV fluids, indications we can broadly put as a replacement of deficit or maintenance to replace the maintenance requirement, because the other routes are not sufficient to maintain the maintenance requirement. Now, difficult questions arrive. Unfortunately, these are day-to-day questions, daily questions. What are the choices available? We have plenty of choices in front of us, be it normoxaline, ringer lactate, balanced solutions, colloids, blood products. So we take decision depending on a few things. We check the fluid volume status. We have to consider the electrolyte status. We have to consider the acid-base status, because some of the fluids can cause derangement of the acid-base status or electrolyte composition. But we have to keep in mind that for whatever indications you may be starting an IV fluid, you have to keep in mind that the IV fluid itself can lead to similar disorders. May not be the same one. It can cause a different kind of disorders. So whatever cause we are compelling you to start a fluid can even lead on to such adverse effects as well if it is not chosen properly. Now, if somebody asks, what are the qualities of an ideal intravenous fluid? So I've tried to list a few. It should achieve desired effect with no tissue storage. It should not have any adverse electrolyte, acid-base, hematological or immunomodulating effects. It should be compatible with the other medicines. It should be affordable. It should be available with long shelf life and reasonable storage requirements. If you note here, we are still searching and we don't have a definite answer until now. But we have many answers, maybe closer to ideal, but still the final answer is still not there. What are the conditions or factors we'll take into account before selecting an IV fluid? We have to go back to our physiology classes. We have been taught like osmolality, tonicity. So all these things are required when you decide to choose an IV fluid. Osmolality is the measure of the osmotic pressure of a solution, but tonicity is actually the effective osmotic pressure in the body. Tonicity of fluid, we can classify our present preparations into maybe isotonic, which has osmolality closer to plasma. We can probably put sodium chloride, but it is slightly on the higher side. Normal, maybe around 280 plus or minus 10, but sodium chloride is around 310. Plasmolite is one of the balanced solutions. Some solutions which are commonly used are hypotonic, actually. It's 0.5% normoxaline, 0.45% sodium chloride, ringer lactate. These are on the hypotonic side. Of course, 3% sodium chloride will be hypertonic. This is another concept we have to be clear, or we should have some idea before we are discussing the negative effects of the IV fluid. Strong ion deficit. Actually, this was put forward by Peter A. Stewart. His school of thought goes like this. There are strong cations and anions in the body. So we are measuring sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium. These are supposed to be the strong cations. Anions mainly taken into account here are chloride and lactate. And since the body is electrically neutral, there should be enough negative anions. Anions are negatively charged to account for the remaining. That includes bicarb. And this difference shaded in blue constitute the strong ion deficit. So now what is the implication with our discussion for crystal, our IV fluid solutions? the normal physiological strong ion deficit is supposed to be 40 plus or minus 2 milliequivalents per liter. If the strong ion deficit reduces, the hydrogen ion increases or the system tends to go towards an acidotic range. Similarly, if the strong ion deficit is much higher, its system might go into an alkalosis state, which is important because the strong ion deficit within the so-called normal saline solution, the strong ions are 154 milliequivalents per liter sodium and the same amount of chloride, the strong ion deficit is zero. Actually, as we infuse more and more normal saline, so-called normal saline or 0.9% sodium chloride solution, we are actually diluting the strong ion deficit, and the strong ion deficit comes down, which actually leads to acidosis. Same, almost the same is the case with Ringer lactate, but it's not to that extent because strong ion deficit within Ringer lactate is 24 milliequivalents per liter. Balanced salt solution is somewhere around 40s. So it is more or less safe in this regard. Another factor is sodium to chloride ratio. If you see the normal sodium to chloride ratio in plasma, it's around 1.4 because the normal sodium is around 135 to 140 and the chloride is around 98 to 103. So the ratio is 1.4. When it comes to 0.9% saline, it is 1, which is away from the normal range. Ringer lactate is 1.2 and balanced crystalloids, which contain almost 50 millimoles per liter of acetate, it's close to 1.4, which is close to the physiological range. So what are the potentially deleterious effects of high chlorate content? If you look at the literature, it will enumerate a lot of deleterious effects, including hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, acute kidney injury because contributed by the acidotic environment. Though sodium 0.9% sodium chloride solution doesn't contain any potassium, it will lead on to hyperkalemia. We'll look into that. It can damage endothelial surface layer. It can increase pro-inflammatory mediators, maybe augment a little bit of sepsis. Detrimental effects on coagulation, detrimental gastrointestinal perfusion function and negative effects, and gastrointestinal uneasiness symptoms at bedside, which is important because this is caused by the over-infusion of maybe 0.9% sodium chloride. Because of this, clinician might think that the patient is still volume depleted, will tend to infuse more of normal saline, which will increase the symptoms further. How does 0.9% normal saline sodium chloride solution result in hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis? We have already mentioned strong ion deficit is zero, so that will cause a dilutional acidosis. Excessive rise in serum chloride will be there. There will be, to compensate for that, there will be excessive renal elimination of bicarbonate. All of will need to saline-induced acidosis. And how does it lead to increase in serum potassium? You know, the chloride ions are accumulating outside the cell. So to balance, there will be more of H+ or acidosis. So H+ can easily cross the cell membrane and get attached to the buffer. Now, to maintain the electrical neutrality, either the chloride ion should come in, which is not possible. So we have to push out some positive ions from inside the cell to outside. So potassium volunteers and goes outside to manage the electrical neutrality. So this will lead to increased serum potassium levels. It may be noted that the tendency towards hyperkalemia will not occur in normochloremic metabolic acidosis because in lactic acidosis or ketoacidosis, the organic anions can enter the intracellular fluid to maintain the electrical neutrality. So we need not sacrifice potassium shift to extracellular space. Now we are coming close to our more balanced salt crystalloids. This is the semi-quantitative Gamble's diagram. Here the sodium, potassium and major components levels are depicted. You can see the sodium levels, 0.9% sodium chloride, it's much ahead of much more than the physiological value. Ringer lactate, actually sodium level is slightly less than the physiological range. Balanced crystalloids, the value is almost close to the physiological range. If you see the chloride levels in 0.9% sodium chloride is 154, which is way higher than the physiological limits. ring electrode is slightly more, and balanced crystalloids is almost around the physiological range. So the evolution of crystalloids from as early as 1850s to from normal saline to ringers, ringer lactate, they present balanced crystalloids, including sterofontin, which came in the early 2000s. We are mostly moving towards a more balanced composition of the crystalloids. If you compare the IV fluids available here, I put the constituents and the osmolality, osmolarity. If you see the 0.9% sodium chloride, I've already mentioned sodium chloride are very much high and the osmolarity is also very high. Ringer lactate, its sodium is less and it's slightly hypoosmolar solution. Balanced salt solutions are reasonably in the physiological range. Though the osmolarity mentioned may be a little high, but product literature says the effective osmolarity is close to the physiological range. Okay, to maintain the balance, they have added acetate, gluconate, or lactate, or maleate. The properties are different. I'm not going into the details because that will be more exhaustive. So I'm trying to wind up intravenous fluids. There are different literature, more theoretical considerations, but do not get drowned in confusion. Our idea is simple. We need to assess the intravenous fluid need. We should know how to give a clear prescription. You have to maintain the quality standards and appropriateness of the fluid is what I would like to stress. So the four basic questions of fluid therapy. One, clinician should know when to start IV fluids and of course when to stop IV fluids. And in critically ill patients, definitely the more questions will come when to start fluid removal and of course when to stop fluid removal. Four indications of fluid therapy, we can classify it as resuscitation purpose, maintenance purpose, replacement purpose, and sometimes for the nutritional purpose also. What is a fluid bolus? Most of the time when the fluid volume status is supposed to be less, we infuse rapid infusion of fluids. It will be given over short periods of time. In clinical practice, a fluid bolus is usually given to correct hypovolemia, hypotension, inadequate blood flow, or impaired microcirculatory perfusion. The minimal fluid volume that is able to increase the backward pressure of venous return is supposed to be 4 mL per kg. And when do you say the patient is clinically fluid responsive? Fluid responsiveness indicates a condition in which the patient will respond to fluid administration by a significant increase in stroke volume and or cardiac output or their surrogates. So this is the magic figure. If the improvement is more than 15%, we can say that the patient is fluid responsive. A fluid bolus is a rapid infusion of fluids infused over a short period of time. And when do you say there is a fluid overload? In critical care settings, we can quantify it. The percentage of fluid accumulation can be calculated as the cumulative fluid balance in liters divided by baseline body weight into 100. And this is the percentage of fluid accumulation. The magic figure we have to remember is 10%. Fluid overload at any stage above 10% is associated with the worst outcomes. And we have to take serious action to avoid that fluid overload. 4 D's of fluid therapy: drug, dose, duration, and de-escalation. We'll go one by one very quickly. As a drug, IV fluid should be considered as a drug. The key factor in empirical fluid therapy is the consideration of the patient risk factors. Patient is the boss. His fluid balance, whether he is in for a fluid overload, capillary leak, his organ function, including renal function, and no recommendation is there to use glucose in resuscitation fluids. We have to weigh the possible benefits like specific fluids for different indications, like whether we are using for resuscitation, maintenance, or replacement, and to avoid toxicity. Hypo or hypertonic, depending on the conditions, high or low chloride sodium level, acetate, bicarbonate buffer, glucose containing or not, whether it will have an impact on the acid-base equilibrium, cellular hydration, electrolyte regulation. And in refractory shock, we have to keep in mind that the longer the delay, the more microcirculatory hypofunction occurs. Regarding the dose, each person in different physiological conditions are different. Pharmacokinetics depends on the type of fluid, distribution volume, osmolality, oncoticity, kidney function, etc. The type of fluid and desired location is dictated by whether it is for resuscitation, we are replacing the interstitial fluid, or intracellular hydration. Some fluids are toxic for the kidneys, but just because of that consideration, you should not deter from administering the fluid therapy, because the longer you wait, kidney might go in for acute kidney injury. So we have to strike a balance between restrictive fluid protocols and liberal fluid protocol. You deviate to either side, you have to tolerate the negative effects or complications. Duration, we have to have clear idea regarding how fast we can stop. There is no strong evidence, but the trend is towards shorter duration. And do not use fluid just to treat a monitored value like a low CVP, MAP, or urine output, but use fluids to treat shock, because the physiology, coming back to taking the patient back to physiological conditions, is the first target. Fluids can be stopped when shock is resolved, indicated by maybe lactate. There are enough studies going on to evaluate the biomarkers in this regard. De-escalation is an important concept that I would like to stress before this audience. After stabilization with early adequate fluid management, like attaining normal pulse pressure variation, normal cardiac output, normal lactate, stop ongoing resuscitation and then switch over to late conservative fluid management and late goal-directed fluid removal. I am introducing yourself, you to this concept: resuscitation, optimization, stabilization, and evacuation. That is the Rose concept in fluid therapy. So in a critically ill patient, the first hit, the initial insult happens, and the first target for us in the early minutes is patient rescue. Here we go to early adequate fluid management. Say 30 mL per kg per first hour you can give, or a fluid challenge or bolus of 4 mL per kg can be given in first 5 to 10 minutes, because our target is patient rescue. Now we go on to the second phase. There is optimization with focusing on organ rescue. Okay, here our idea is to have a neutral fluid balance. And in the subsequent days, we change our strategy to late conservative fluid management. Our idea is to target organ support or homeostasis. Then in the next week, after initial 2 to 4 days, we switch over to late goal-directed fluid removal, because the patient must be going, switching over from the ebb phase to flow phase, where the patient might start becoming flushing out the additional fluids. So you try to go along with that and try to reduce the goal-directed fluid removal will be the strategy. The idea is to help in organ recovery. So this is the ROSE, ROS concept in fluid therapy. So this is in nutshell regarding the basics of fluid therapy. These are my references. I think we may be able to share the resources. These are the wonderful articles which will give you a great insight into what's actually happening in the area of fluid management and fluid therapy. This will help you refine the strategies, and we are moving more towards evidence-based practice, even with regard to fluid therapy. With that, I'm winding my session. Thanks again for the organizers from Esculap Academy for involving me in this academic platform. I think we can switch over to Dr. Anoop's lecture on the second part of the program. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanish. And now may I request Dr. Anoop to initiate his talk. We will take the questions after both the lectures are over. Thank you so much.
One minute. Can you just allow my video? Okay. Good evening, friends. I'm back again after a few days gap, and really happy to see you all again after a short gap. So this topic actually we have discussed in detail before, but today we'll be discussing that in view of COVID. So as you are well aware, the main cause of mortality in COVID patients is ARDS, and a appropriate fluid management has a significant role in reducing mortality in any ARDS patient. And we have already discussed the concept of balanced salt solution, and we will see what is the evidence or like what is the expert consensus and guidelines on use of the crystalloid, colloid, or the balanced salt solution in a COVID patient. So this crystalloid colloid debate is there for a long time. So, and again, the Dr. Sanish has already discussed that in detail. So usually crystalloid, it compensates for the extracellular fluid loss, and colloid is basically like an intra compensate for a basically an intravascular fluid loss. But even though we think that the oncotic pressure, everything can be maintained well with a colloid, as you are well aware, in the last talk, we have discussed the evidence in detail about colloid. So there is an increasing evidence that the colloids can worsen acute kidney injury, especially in a septic or a patient hypotensive patient. And same way, colloid can also aggravate endothelial damage or the glycocalyx damage. And obviously, it can also have a coagulopathic defect as well. And the more studies are on with starch, definitely the starch is has shown an increased mortality in all those groups. But the evidence for gelatin is also lacking now. So even gelatin, we don't have a strong evidence to do to use in sepsis or in an ARDS. If you want to use a colloid, the only the colloid with a evidence nowadays is only albumin. And again, when we use albumin, it is not the 20% albumin. There is a 5% albumin which can be used as a resuscitative colloid. So this is about the endothelial damage I was talking about. Especially when you over-resuscitate the patient, Dr. Sanish has described that in detail, it can definitely produce an endothelial damage. And when there is an endothelial damage, the fluid shift between an intracellular space and an extracellular space is more, and obviously can produce more leaky capillaries. So this can be because of many reasons, like even hypotension can cause an over fluid loss, over fluid treatment, and over like a high amount of fluids can produce a damage of endothelium. And there are many other insults as well, like your cytokine storm, sepsis, all those can produce an endothelial damage. So coming to the principles of ARDS management, this is very well applicable in a COVID patient as well. So as you are well aware, there are many treatment strategies tried in COVID. But as of now, only few things are having evidence in COVID management. One thing is obviously the conservative fluid management, followed by the prone ventilation, especially awake proning is having a definite role in reducing mortality. And obviously the lung protective strategy, which we are following for all types of ARDS with the low tidal volume. So we'll be concentrating more on the conservative fluid management. What is the concept of conservative fluid management? Dr. Sanish has already given you an overview about this Rose concept, all those things. I'll be concentrating more about that, especially in the context of an ARDS. And the prone ventilation, I've already told, and we have discussed the CARP protocol of self-pruning, etc., which in coming sessions we can have a detailed discussion, especially the pruning with nasal oxygen or like a non-rebreathing mask, high flow nasal oxygen, or even NIV, how to do that and what are the advantages. And the lung protective we have already discussed in detail. So this conservative fluid management concept, this was evolved especially in an ARDS management from the FAG trial, which is called fluid and catheter treatment trial, which was appeared in 2006 in NEJM. So it is appropriate to guide fluid resuscitation by measures of fluid responsiveness. So we should not look at CVP or any other static parameters, but we have to look at responsiveness. What is fluid responsiveness? I think in one session we have already described that. And volume responsiveness should be assessed by dynamic rather than static parameters, and there are many dynamic parameters for that. And even in this FAG trial, what they found is, like any septic patient, when they are coming to the ICU, you may have to aggressively resuscitate them in the initial 24 hours. So after that 24 hours, the mortality was significantly low when you are keeping a negative fluid balance. Or in other words, even in the group of patients where you were aiming for a negative fluid balance, in the initial 24 hours, there were actually a positive fluid balance. Or you may have to give a volume balancing with a crystalloid or whatever it may be in the initial 24 hours. So that concept should be very clear. Even if you aim for a negative fluid balance, the initial hours, it's very crucial. You have to maintain adequate volume status. So what is the relation between intravascular volume and pulmonary edema in ARDS? So this is very, very crucial. That is why we always say that you should not give more fluid. It can directly sweep into the lungs and can increase the hypoxemia or the alveolar damage. So in short, ARDS is a form of non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema, as we all know, in which extravascular lung water increases due to increased pulmonary capillary permeability. So being a non-cardiogenic, the basic pathology is like increased pulmonary capillary permeability. Okay, we will come to that in detail. So a fluid balance across the pulmonary capillary wall is related both to the hydrostatic and osmotic pressure difference between the intravascular and interstitial space. I will explain that with a diagram. So we have an endothelium, there is a small pores in that, and we have a plasma and then an interstitial fluid. So basically, we've already described, whenever there is a endothelial damage or this glycocalyx is damaged, obviously your pore size will increase and definitely there can be a leakage of fluid. Okay, so that is one thing. So other leakage is basically depending on the filtration force. So what is the filtration force? There is a hydrostatic pressure in the capillaries and in the interstitial space. So if the hydrostatic pressure is more, obviously the sweepage will be more. So the hydrostatic pressure can be more because if there is a more fluid volume, obviously your hydrostatic pressure will be more. Or you can have a osmotic pressure difference, like especially the plasma osmotic pressure difference minus the interstitial osmotic pressure. So when this the interstitial osmotic pressure is less, again there can be a fluid sweepage. So the way by which you can reduce the non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema will be to reduce this, the difference between these hydrostatic pressures, or obviously the difference between the osmotic pressures. So the attempts to minimize intravascular pressure could decrease the edema. Obviously, we have explained that. And degree of resorption of fluid will be more when intravascular osmotic pressure is high. Okay. So even if you have an intravascular osmotic pressure high, initially that may be immaterial. But once this fluid start resolving by this Levick's paper, having a high intravascular osmotic pressure is better for an early resolution of edema. So what is the significance of that? Can anyone give that views on that? Please, I'm looking for your chat. So I've told you there is an initial phase the degree of the fluid resorption is basically depending on the intravascular oncotic pressure. So in management wise, this Levick's paper, which way you can put, you can chart, you can give the opinion. Or in other words, I can give you one more clue. Suppose I want to increase the intravascular oncotic pressure. What is the option I have? Infuse albumin. Yeah, excellent. So Nitin, got it. No, please wait. So my question is not that. Infusing albumin is the best way to increase the intravascular oncotic pressure. So in an ARDS patient, at what point of time you are going to infuse the albumin? So that is what you have to infer from this Levick's paper. No, yeah, 5% albumin or 20% albumin, that's fine. I'm asking about at what phase. Will you give it an early phase of ARDS to prevent the developing ARDS? Okay, Anil is saying it early phase. Or in de-resuscitation phase, or in the when the patient is going for a severe ARDS. No, everyone is typing early phase. No, again, please listen. The resorption of fluid will be more when the intravascular oncotic pressure is high. So the resorption of fluid is required when there is a resolution of ARDS. So you need increased oncotic pressure towards the later stages of ARDS or towards the resolution of ARDS. So once there is a early phase of ARDS, when the patient is developing an ARDS, obviously by increasing the more oncotic pressure, it may not be helpful, or if you give an albumin at that point of time, definitely the ARDS may worsen. But towards the end, once this ARDS is established and you give PEEP, you try to ventilate or you try to prone, whatever it may be, at that point of time, the papers have shown that especially the group of the cohort of patients with low albumin, especially less than 3 gram per deciliter, giving albumin may be helpful. But obviously, we don't have enough clinical data to support that. This is based on assumptions. None of the papers or RCTs have shown that an infusing albumin at a later phase of ARDS can reduce the mortality, but you have to keep in mind, this is one way. Another thing is obviously to reduce the incidence of AKI or increasing the renal perfusion also, increasing the intravascular oncotic pressure will be helpful. So in an ARDS established patient with leaky capillaries, a resuscitation option with a 5% albumin will be slightly better than with a crystalloid. That is what I was trying to convey. Now, so hypovolemia, as you know, it's very common in critically ill COVID patients. And there should be different parameters you should establish how to assess that. And evidence of shock in critically ill patient was almost 35%, and it is 50% in non-survivor population. Or in other words, we can say whenever there is a shock in COVID patient, the mortality will be high. Okay, that is the inference. So, but what are the causes of shock? True, it can be because of hypovolemia, but don't forget the incidence of cardiac injury, myocarditis, LV dysfunction is very, very high in COVID patients. So you have to always do a screening echo and see there is no cardiac injury, or you can look at acute cardiac markers also for the evidence of myocarditis. Or the patient can have an increase secondary sepsis as well, and which is very difficult to differentiate as well. ARDS is already there is a question ARDS already endothelial damage. If we start in early phase, again albumin will get leakage. No more benefit, no sir. I didn't get you. In ARDS already there is an endothelial damage. If we start, but that's why early phase there is no improvement. That's what I told. So why there is hypovolemia in COVID patients? There are many reasons. One is obviously fever. Second is mouth breathing, and we know that majority of the patients will be in L group with high compliance and very high tidal volume. Obviously, with high tidal volume, you will be having high minute ventilation. So high minute ventilation, there will be more lose the humidity more. So obviously, there may be a fluid loss through the respiratory tract. Patient will be anxious, etc. May be having decreased fluid intake. Some patients may be having a gastrointestinal problem, so fluid loss may be there. a patient may be depressed, may not take enough water, intubation, sedation, all those things can again produce hypovolemia. Okay, so this is the main problems of hypovolemia and how you can assess, like we have discussed in previous classes, like a passive leg raise. What the advantage of passive leg raise is? What is the advantage of passive leg raise over a like mini fluid challenge? So once you give a mini fluid challenge, you don't have an option to take the fluid back. But in a passive leg raise, so once you give a leg raise, there will be obviously more like volume coming to the heart from the lower limb. And once you keep the lower limb down, again that volume will be pulled in the lower limb. So that is reversible. A PLR is a reversible fluid challenge, but a mini fluid challenge is irreversible. So that is why in an ARDS patient, having a PLR will be having more clinical benefit. A lactate clearance may be used, but always keep in mind, in a patient with COVID, an increased lactate can be because of many reasons. It can be because of a myocardial injury. It can be because of a tissue damage, cytokine storm, or different reasons. So having a high lactate is not an indication for fluid resuscitation. That should be very clear. There can be pulse pressure variation. This is also should be very careful. And a non-ventilated patient with a high tidal volume with increased PMS, which we have already described in the previous classes, where there is more the thoracic pressure swing. So when there is a more thoracic pressure swing, obviously the pulse pressure variation also will be high. So in a non-intubated patients, if you get a high pulse pressure variation, doesn't tell you that the patient is having a hypovolemia. Or in other words, looking at a PPV in an awake hyperventilating patient, don't decide about hypovolemia. IVC collapsibility and distensibility. This is also should be assessed very, very carefully. A common mistake done by other critical care and ED residents. So first of all, you have to keep in mind one concept. Why we are looking an IVC size or an IVC collapsibility index? To see whether the patient is volume responsive or not. So to see whether the patient is volume responsiveness or not, the patient should have any of the clinical features of hypovolemia, like the patient is having a low BP or a decreased urine output, or maybe like if all other parameters are absolutely normal, you can have an elevated lactate. You should not have any other feature by which a lactate elevation can be explained. So in that situation, if you find an IVC, a very collapsed IVC, obviously you can give fluid and can try to increase the preload. Otherwise, if the IVC is completely collapsed, the patient is absolutely fine, no evidence of a hyperperfusion, don't give fluid. Because I've seen many times, especially the ED residents looking at IVC giving fluid bolus. So please don't give that. To give an IV fluid bolus, you have to see that either the BP is low or the patient is having any of the features of hypovolemia. Again, IVC variations can also be seen in a patient with high tidal volume variation. A patient with a high volume swing can again show, just like PPV variation, IVC collapsibility can also be high, or IVC diameter will be varying. So that is also not an indication that the patient is hypovolemic. And there are many other recommendations, like the crystalloids. I've already told you, even the sepsis surviving sepsis guidelines, all the guidelines recommends crystalloids as the better fluid for resuscitation. And albumin should be considered, as we have already discussed, when the serum albumin is low. So what data should guide the fluid management? You have to see a few points. Like when the patient is not having a shock, if the BP is absolutely normal, as I've already told, there is no indication for giving a maintenance fluid in a ICU patient. You can give feed them enterally, or like either orally or enterally, depending on the patient's sensorium. But there is no indication for maintenance fluid. So be very careful, very clear about that. Even I've seen even people putting a maintenance solution to maintain the central line. You don't need a fluid to maintain the patency of central line. Okay, so every day when you assess the patient, you see the fluid balance is adequate and make sure that the patient is not receiving any unnecessary fluid. That should be very clear. and diuretics will normalize the volume status until of the ventilator as tolerated. Okay, if the patient is on ventilator, always try to keep a negative fluid balance. The one way of doing that is obviously start the patient on diuretic, but at the same time you see the third point that you should always hold the diuretic for rising creatinine, and or like if the urine is seen as like concentrated, or when the urine is having active sediment. You forget about the last part, but especially when the creatinine is showing a rising trend, you should never continue the diuretic infusion. That patient may be hypovolemic. So if you excuse the intravascular compartment again, obviously your AKI may be getting precipitated. So if the and another clinical point is, if the patient is become hypotensive on a small increase in PEEP, suppose the patient was initially on 5 PEEP, you increase to 8, the BP is suddenly dropping. It is not because of the PEEP effect alone, but it is because of the less fluid status. So that is a situation where you have to consider hypovolemia and you will have to supplement fluid. I think those points are very clear. I'll repeat these points again, because it is very, very important in managing an ARDS or a COVID patient. You have to don't give a maintenance fluid unless there is it is indicated like the patient is hypovolemic. You can always use a diuretic in an ARDS patient to aim for a negative fluid balance. At the same time, if the creatinine values are rising or the BP is falling, you should hold the diuretic infusion. And if the patient is becoming hypotensive on slight increase in the PEEP, that is an indication that the patient is hypovolemic, and you will have to give fluid to maintain the fluid balance in such patients. So now another important point, should enteral intake could be calculated in the total fluid balance? This is another lesson, which is an unintended lesson, in fact, from the FACT trial. So usually when we measure a fluid balance in the ICU, we look at the total fluid intake and the total fluid output. So we take all the feed as well. So, but see the paper or see the data what we gathered from the FACT trial. Here you can see this is the data from the FACT trial, alveolar trial, and the ARMA the papers as well. So this is the one with the conservative fluid strategy. Here in the conservative fluid strategy, you can see the cumulative fluid balance is significantly increasing over the initial 7 days. But in all other strategies, the cumulative fluid balance is going high, especially with the deliberate fluid strategy. Okay. But at the same time, you see, if you look at the intravascular pressure by the pulmonary arterial occlusion pressure, or you look at CVP, the difference is not that significant. Even though the cumulative fluid balance is going high, the liberal versus conservative group will not show a significant increase in the CVP, or the CVP is showing a decremental status. Here also you can see the CVP is showing a decremental status. This is again explained probably because of the enteral intake may not contribute to the total fluid intake. So in other words, even if you are in a doubt about the fluid intake, if you are enterally giving the fluid, like the, you can increase the feed, the quantity, like a 2 liter or 2.5 liter, that is unlikely to negatively affect the oxygenation status or the ARDS. Okay, so that is a better option. Rather than giving an IV crystalloid or an IV albumin, if you hydrate the patient properly through enterally, it is unlikely to deteriorate the pulmonary arterial occlusion pressure, or as I've already told, the pulmonary hydrostatic pressure. So the fluid seepage into the lungs is unlikely. Okay, so that is another way of hydrating patient properly. So there are many consensus on the fluid management in COVID therapy. This is many patients, this is a critical care group. We are mainly concentrating on multiple aspects of this pandemic. The general principles of fluid management in critical care provides the foundation of fluid therapy. It is not different from a normal ARDS patient. Only thing I've already described, because of high tidal volume or the cytokine storm or the sweating, etc., there may be more fluid loss, which you should not miss that. During the early stages of COVID pandemic, it was a common advice to aim for a negative fluid balance. But recently, there has been called for more liberal fluid strategy, which I've already explained, because nowadays the chances of AKI in COVID patients are increasing. So when you are using diuretics and aiming for a negative fluid balance, you should be very careful about raising creatinine and worsening AKI. It is important to take a concise history, clinically assess the patient, and individualize the therapy. I've already described you what are the importance of all this history, like especially regarding the fluid loss. And several guidelines have been published in management of the fluid management. And ultrasound is really helpful in assessing the fluid status of the patient, which we will explain. And there is little doubt that the fluid therapy, either too much or too little, can adversely affect the patient. So you need always an optimal therapy, which we have clearly described. And Dr. Sanish has initially described you the concept of deresuscitation. So in general, a judicious fluid strategy whereby fluid is cautiously administered only after a pre-rod responsiveness has been assessed or advised as preferable. Okay. So we know, like I've told you, how to look for a preload responsiveness, either by a mini fluid challenge or by an SLR test. So given the incidence of myocardial dysfunction in subset patients, early use of vasopressors or inotropes alongside regular assessment by echocardiography for looking at LV systolic function would be helpful. Or in other words, you have to always look at myocardial function in a hypotensive patient. And if the hypotension is because of myocardial dysfunction, obviously you have to use inotropes to improve the contractility. If you give more and more fluid, definitely the patient will be going for a cardiogenic pulmonary edema, and again your ARDS will be getting worsened. So what are the guidelines available at present on fluid management? Again, these are all expert consensus guidelines. There is no RCT to say that this fluid is better than the other. But based on these guidelines, first we go to the surviving sepsis guidelines. So they are having 4 points. You can see the weak recommendation, then the quality of evidence. So the measuring dynamic parameters to assess fluid responsiveness, which I've already told, whenever you have you need a parameter, that should be a dynamic parameter, or you should not look at CVP. Using a conservative fluid administration strategy, that I've already explained how to do that. Using crystalloid is preferable to colloids. That is always a strong recommendation with moderate quality. Okay, so don't use colloids at all. Okay, especially anesthesiologists are having the habit of using more and more colloids, but be careful in an ICU patient, especially sick patients. And balanced crystalloid preferred over unbalanced crystalloid. This is again moderate quality of evidence. So whenever you use the crystalloid, always try to use a balanced crystalloid. The Dr. Sanish has clearly explained the problems with hyperchloremic acidosis, the hyperchloremic acidosis, again, how it can worsen the acidosis, how it can produce more renal artery constriction, and again, how it can produce more AKI. Now coming to the WHO recommendation. Here again, all the guidelines recommend on conservative fluid management, but obviously without tissue hyperperfusion. This is all what we have discussed, just putting in guidelines. In resuscitation for septic shock in adult, 500 ml of crystalloid fluid as a rapid bolus in first 30 minutes. The problem with the WHO guidelines always is WHO guidelines are always targeted for third world countries. So they always give us an under evidence or a guidelines which is for resource limited areas. So, but you know, like majority of the Indian ICUs nowadays are well equipped and it is at par with any best Western ICUs. So we have all gadgets to look at fluid response CNS. There is, so I don't recommend giving a 500 ml of crystalloid balance, fluid bolus. Instead of that, you can go with a mini fluid challenge or like a SLR in that. So is there no response to fluid loading, or if there is signs of fluid overload appear, you have to discontinue fluid administration. Again, I will say it is completely against critical care principles. You cannot give fluid and make pulmonary edema, then see that the patient is developing pulmonary edema and stop fluid. That is not a recommended practice in critical care. But as I've already told, if you don't have any gadgets to assess the fluid responsiveness, obviously that is a one tool by which you can do. Suppose if you have an ultrasound, what you can do, you look at the scans in lung scan, see whether the patient is having like a B lines. So if early development of B line itself is an indication to stop the fluid, ideally you should not even develop a B lines in lungs and worsen the oxygenation. Or in ventilator also you can see the airway pressure is increasing or the saturation is dropping. All these indicates that, or the plateau pressure are going high or the driving pressure going high, all these indicates that the lungs are getting flooded. You should not continue the fluid at that point. And obviously the dynamic indices, there is no doubt about that. And starches are associated with increased death and AKI compared to crystalloids. And hypotonic solutions are less effective at increasing intravascular volume. So you should not use a hypotonic solution. So these consensus are completely agreed. Now look at another body's recommendation, which is UK Joint Anesthetic and Intensive Care Guidelines. Again, almost all these things are almost same. Conservative fluid, everyone is recommending conservative fluid strategy. And in case of significant hypotension or circulatory shock, standard circulatory assessment should be done. A balanced electrolytes solutions are preferred over colloid. Balanced solutions are preferred over normal saline. And again, at this point, if you're not worried about lactate clearance, Erlinger lactate is also a cheaper option, maybe in an intense scenario. But if affordable, always go for a balanced salt solution. While fluid overload should be avoided and more conservative administration may help to improve respiratory function, this should be carefully balanced against risk of inducing renal impairment, which we have discussed. Care should be exercised in rendering patients too dry. That can also be detrimental, which we have already discussed. So the International Fluid Academy also recommends almost same. The recent lab data with urea and electrolyte. So they at least 24 hours, they recommend urea and electrolyte. That is otherwise also you should do. At least sodium, potassium, and calcium should be checked every day in a sick patient. And use of cardiac output monitor to assess fluid responsiveness. So if you have a cardiac output monitor, it's well and good. Or you can make use of an ultrasound to see the cardiac output or fluid responsiveness. This International Fluid Academy also in resuscitation, they recommend balanced crystalloid. So as you can see, that's all guidelines. It's all favoring of balanced crystalloid and it is strongly against a star solution. And this International Fluid Academy strongly discourage use of gelatin as well. So don't think that the gelatin can be used instead of a star. No, if you want to use as a colloid, always go for albumin. And do not use albumin in early stages, which I've already described what is a problem with that. And mean arterial pressure and cardiac output are continuously monitored and assess the presence of fluid overload. The fluid bolus part, which we have already told. The International Fluid Academy in maintenance also, they are clearly showed. There is no, don't have to administer maintenance fluid, especially if the patient is having enough gastric tolerance. And there is something called a fluid creep. Like all sources of fluid administered need to be detailed. So that is another issue, like especially enteral, parenteral, all products should be included. And here I have explained you, the enteral will not cause much harm like that much of a parenteral one. But in the parenteral, you should include all the drugs what you are infusing, because nowadays we go for continuous antibiotic infusions, for which again, you will be using fluids. And an electrolyte imbalance in patients with severe coronavirus disease. This is a journal from article from Annals of Clinical Biochemistry. So here again, you can see the sodium, potassium, and chloride and calcium these are in the severe disease was showing low sodium, potassium and calcium and high chloride. So always you have to monitor all those things. Usually the ABG will be showing sodium, potassium and calcium and chloride. So your whenever you take an ABG in your or when you are opting an ABG machine, make sure that that is having potassium, chloride, calcium and sodium. So only by doing an ABG every day, you can get a clear cut idea about all these parameters. So in our ICUs, like we usually don't separately ask for a lab value. The values in the ABG, if you are having a good ABG machine, that is well correlated. So you don't have to repeat a serum values again. The whatever values you are getting, ABG can be taken. And again, one more point you have to consider at this point is, suppose today the patient potassium is 2.8. You are giving almost say 80 milliequivalents of potassium. So the next day also the potassium is coming 2.4. You give again 2.8. You give again 80 milliequivalents. So what you have to understand from that, the requirement, daily requirement of potassium in that patient is not 80. It may be something like 120 or 140. So you should always assess what is the potassium requirement in 24 hours and don't try to give it only a dose in the morning. You give a continuous dose or try to give the total potassium requirement in the 24 hours and avoid developing hypokalemia in that patient. Okay. There is no point that you give a potassium every day morning and next day morning the patient is becoming hypokalemic. That means the supplementation what you are giving is inadequate. That should not happen. So this is a pooled analysis, which I've already told you. The patient who are becoming sicker, so they have shown to have all these things, hypokalemia, hyponatremia, and hypocalcemia along with hyperchloremia. Okay. So with that, actually, I've given you an overview about the ARDS management, the COVID management, how to optimize the fluid management in a COVID patient. And regarding the balanced fluid therapy, Dr. Sanish has clearly described the concept regarding that. So now I think we will move on to the questions. So the first question is, in majority of trauma patient resuscitated by normal saline in casualty presents with hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis with early stages of AKI. What will be your fluid of choice resource limited setting when balanced fluid is not available? I've already told you, there is a problem with the ATLS guidelines. So this you have to avoid like a hypo oncotic solutions in a patient with head injury. That is true. Or a patient with a severe traumatic brain injury, as you want more sodium, obviously a normal saline will be a better resuscitating fluid, especially when the patient is having a head injury. But all other cases go for a balanced whole solution. And if it is a resource limited and the cost is a main constraint in that case, you can go for a Ringer lactate, but make sure that the liver is normal and liver can actually metabolize the lactate what you are giving. Okay. Otherwise, Ringer lactate is also a very good solution and you don't have to worry about the blood sugars, all those things which we have discussed very well. That the sugar rise which is going to happen with the Ringer lactate infusion is very, very minimal. Plus for above patient in maintenance phase, if hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis is present with normal high potassium, what kind of fluids you prefer? I've already told you there is no concept of maintenance fluid in any ICU patient. You don't need a maintenance fluid at all. You see what is the problem. If the patient is not having hypovolemia, why you need a resuscitation fluid? But in your case, if the patient is having hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis with normal or high potassium, obviously in normal potassium, I think balanced salt solution is ideal. High potassium, depending on what is the cause of potassium. If the potassium is very high, obviously we will have to use a fluid which is having a very minimal potassium, like something like a normal saline itself, we will have to use in that situation. That is why you will have to see whether the one thing you have to always keep in mind whenever you get a high potassium value, in an ICU patient, you have to see whether it is an acidosis induced. If it is an acidosis induced, especially like a hyperchloremic acidosis, if it is inducing hyperkalemia, obviously giving more saline will give you a more worsening hyperkalemia. That is why you see what is the cause of hyperkalemia. Like if there is a problem with the potassium clearance through the kidney, obviously reducing the potassium intake through the feed, through the fluid, everything will be advisable. Otherwise, you can go with the other fluid itself. In severe stage of ARDS or resolution stage of ARDS, to consider albumin. No, I have clearly told you, don't think that you have to give albumin to increase the resolution or to enhance the resolution of ARDS. I've never told you like that. Like if you want to resuscitate a patient, or if you feel that the patient is like a preload depleted, and if you want to give a fluid, in initial phase, crystalloid will be preferable. But in a later phase, especially when the serum albumin values are low, as a resuscitation fluid, you can use 5% albumin. So please don't mistake. You should not give an albumin for resolution of ARDS. Don't give like that. If you want a fluid resuscitation in a patient with low albumin, at a phase of resolution, the preferred fluid will be albumin. So that is what I've told. Are there exact definition of fluid bolus, fluid challenge, and mini fluid challenge? Again, that depends. The fluid challenge can be defined as 250 ml. A mini fluid challenge will be somewhere around 100 ml. That depending on the papers, it is different. And usually it is over 10 to 15 minutes. But always I've told you, it is a dynamic thing. I don't believe these blind equations of 30 ml per kg, 500 ml, etc. If you're working in a good ICU, don't go for all those things. If you are in a resource limited area, you can go with a WHO guidelines, what we have already discussed. Are there exact definitions of, we have already told, mini fluid challenge already we told. B-lines in USG is always fluid overload. No. Sriram, that is a very, very important question. Suppose if the patient is already having an ARDS. ARDS, as you have already told, is a non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Obviously, you will be having a B-lines in that. Suppose the patient is having a severe pulmonary fibrosis. The patient is having a pleural thickening. You can have a B-line in that situation also. That is why you have to look at a serial ultrasound and a patient with a very minimal B-line. Now it is increasing, especially after a fluid bolus. That means it may be because of fluid overload. Okay, an ARDS patient having a B-line doesn't mean that the patient is having a fluid overload. I think it's very clear in that. Sir, normal saline will cause more potassium. So what in hyperkalemia? No, I didn't say like that. What I told you is, it is normal saline will not produce hyperkalemia. What I was trying to tell you was, usually in a hyperkalemia, one of the cause may be metabolic acidosis. Like in ABG class also, we have clearly explained that. In a diabetic ketoacidosis, the potassium will be high. That is because of the potassium shift from the intracellular space to the extracellular level. Okay. In that situation, if you worsen the metabolic acidosis by giving normal saline, that can worsen hyperkalemia. So what I was saying is, you should not worsen your metabolic acidosis by giving normal saline. But if you feel that hyperkalemia is because of some other reasons, obviously you have to give a fluid with a very less potassium. Sanir sir, you want to add anything at that point?
Yeah, and actually I was looking at the questions that our IV fluid itself can lead to hyperkalemia. That doesn't mean that whatever hyperkalemia patient has is attributable to our fluids. And IV fluids choice per se is not the only solution for managing the hyperkalemia also, because we can institute other anti-kalemia measures and proceed with the fluid resuscitation. That is one thing. And actually, I was amused at seeing the our poll results. Can I share that for a moment?
Yeah, please.
Because we have tried to understand what is the actual practices, and all our reassuring responses. So which is the IV fluid commonly used in your institution for resuscitation fluid? 41% says normal saline, 41% Ringer lactate, balanced crystalloid, the percentage is less. But I think as time goes by, the percentages will keep changing.
No, and can you just go back, sir, once the previous layer? So one thing I wanted to add at this point, I think in my previous presentation, I've added this slide, there was an international survey, a point time survey looking at different ICUs. So here, this is the world over, this is happening. It is not in the problem with your ICU alone. The world over, the trend is like this only. The nowhere it is completely moved on to balanced crystalloid, but as Anil sir has already told, it is really increasing. But I'm really happy to see that the Ringer lactate use is almost equal to normal saline, or your normal saline use is not very high. I think in majority of the Indian ICUs, it is normal saline is the leading. So I'm very happy to see that. And again, the colloid is zero. That is also, I'm really, really excited to see that. We have taken multiple classes, but still people were using colloid. So here it's 0% use in different ICUs. That is also really an exciting point.
Yeah, and at least our audience is more getting updated. And what is the most important target while selecting your IV fluid for resuscitation? Majority have mentioned it's volume status rather than the other accessory factors, including sodium level, chloride level, and acid-base status. And what according to you is the main drawback with the balanced crystalloids? I think they have mentioned all of the above. That means a little bit of availability issues there, cost factor, and unfamiliarity with the new product. It's also there, and lack of exposure, the literature exposure, and knowledge regarding the or acquaintance regarding the pharmacological properties. All of this we can come over by clinical meetings like this, and more of awareness and discussion, so that we can refine our local institutional protocols. Anup, you want to?
No, I think there's an exact reflection of the impression what you are getting when we are talking to the ICU people. I think it's exact reflection of what is seen in Indian ICUs.
Yeah, anyway, that trend is towards switching over to balanced IV fluids. And one more thing I want to emphasize here is the literature I have shown, they are giving wonderful depictions of what happens when the infusion is given over 30 minutes, 60 minutes, and given over a long period. So here you can see the expansion of plasma volume in mLs after intravenous infusion of 500 ml colloid versus 1 liter of Ringer lactate. That is given in the dashed line when administered in an adult patient of average weight 80 kg over 30 minutes. That is the red one. Next, black one is over 60 minutes, and then over a long period of time. Maybe it's around 180 minutes. Actually, the traces are almost chasing each other, and maybe the volume retained, volume expansion is less when we give it over a longer period of time. But actually that is sustained, and that will maintain the volume for a longer period of time as well. It depends on what exactly is your requirement, rather than having a one-stop solution for all our requirements. So it's a dynamic thing. We have mentioned as a context-sensitive decision-making. Whatever decision we take at 0.0 may not be the decision at 30, 60. And different phases we have already mentioned, the ebb phase and the flow phase. Depending on that, we have to cater our fluid strategies. Any more questions?
Another one question, why there is no hyperkalemia in lactic and ketosis? Any acidosis you will be having the potassium shift. There is nothing like in one group of acidosis. In patients with raised lactate, can we give Ringer lactate? Depends again, what is the cause of high lactate, especially if the problem with the lactate clearance, and if you have a persistent lactic acidosis, it is better to avoid using high lactate solutions. I think we have covered almost all questions. And again, thank you so much for the excellent interaction. And I think we have covered almost the concept of fluid management in ARDS, and at the same time, the concept of balanced soul solution as well. Over to the our Escalab people.
So thank you, Dr. Sanish and Dr. Anoop, for an excellent, excellent session. So much interaction with the group and with your expertise and experience of clinical practices. I think we are extremely happy that all the questions also could be answered in the time slot which was available. And this is and thank you also for taking all the questions online, and we thank all the participants and all our faculty for this excellent session, and all the participants for joining and being so interactive. In case of you have any questions, please contact the email ID which is given in the box, as well as please provide us your feedback after this webinar. This will help us getting all future programs aligned in the way people are looking at it. So on behalf of Escalab Academy and B. Brown Medical India Private Limited, I thank our eminent faculty and all the participants. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very
much. And Varsha, one request, like if you can share the recorded version, we can share with our attendees.
Yes, sir. Sure. So we will be sharing the recording done to both of you, and this can be used for any educational purpose in future. Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.